Namaste. Namaste. I am Jyoti Chigallapalli from International Institute of Vedic Sciences, Rishi Vatika. I welcome you all, the enthusiasts of Vedic Sciences and Sanatana Dharma, who have joined us live on the Rishi Vatika YouTube channel today. Let us start this session with a short prayer. Gurur Brahma, Gurur Vishnu, Gurur Devo Maheshwaraha, Guru Sakshat Parabrahma, Tasmai Sri Gurave Namaha. Manojavam Marta Tulya Vegam, Jitendriyam Buddhimatam Varishtam, Vatatmajam Vanarayoda Mukhyam, Sri Ramadutam Sirasa Namami. So here we have with us Srimati Uttara Nerurkarji, the speaker of the day. Namaste and welcome, Uttaraji. Today, Srimati Uttaraji will be giving a talk on introduction to Manusmriti. Manusmriti is an ancient legal text among the many Dharma Shastras of Hinduism. It presents itself a discourse given by Manu, Svayambhuva, and Bhrigu on Dharma topics such as duties, rights, laws, conduct, virtues, and others. This is the 56th talk in Dr. Vedavyasa Memorial Online Lecture Series being conducted by International Institute of Vedic Sciences, promoted by Vedavyasam Bharati Trust, USCAFI, and Yoga Brotherhood of America, with the blessings of Pooja Guruji Dr. Vedavyas. So thanks to IIVS for giving me this opportunity to introduce Srimati Uttara Nerurkarji today. Srimati Uttara Nerurkarji is a Vedic scholar who has been studying Vedas, Upanishads, Darshana Shastras, and other such ancient texts, along with Sanskrit, both Laukik and Vedic. She has been studying and teaching Sanskrit, Upanishads, Manusmriti for the past 10 plus years. She has been regularly writing in Vedic magazines such as Dayananda Sandesh, Vedvani, Ved Jyoti, etc. She has given presentations in schools, colleges, and other community forums. She has given pravachans in community gatherings. She has also been producing videos which were posted in public domain. Her papers have been presented in national and international conferences. She has done BTech from IIT Kanpur and has worked for 15 years as a process engineer and a software professional. As a software researcher at Infosys, her papers were published in international journals and presented them at international conferences. During this lecture, if you have any questions or comments, please post them in comment section. Now I request Srimati Uttaraji to deliver her talk. Madam, over to you.
Thank you, Jyoti. Let me also start with a prayer.
Sure.
Om Vishwani Deva Savitar Duritani Parasuva Yat Khatram Tannasuva Om Shanti Shanti Shanti.
Namaste to all the viewers. I'm really happy that I'm able to present my views on certain topics to all of you. And really great that you have interest in such matters. First, I would actually like to really thank the International Institute of Vedic Sciences and Dr. Gadadharji, who I presume has discovered me on LinkedIn. And I'm really honored to have this opportunity to share my views with all of you. This project of Rishi Vatika, which IIVS is conducting, is something which is like a dream project for me. I would also like to, for Vedic studies to spread all over the world. However, I am not able to do it to this extent. I really give my blessings to IIVS that it may go to greater and greater heights. And my respected pranams to Gurudev Ji, Vedavyasa Ji. He has done a great job, and I'm really happy that this IIVS Institute has been established under his guidance. Okay, so let me start with the presentation proper. I will share my screen now with you. So So today we are going to discuss Manusmriti. This is a very ancient text, and probably you have heard more negative things about it than positive things. So in today's presentation, I hope to tell you some of the greatnesses of Manusmriti, some of the unique features which are there, and also to cover some of the controversies which surround this and be able to remove some of the misconceptions. With that, let me... start with the introduction. Manusmriti is considered the first book of law. We know that Vedas are the first book in the library of mankind. Similarly, this is the first book of law. This law is not the way we envisage a law in terms of criminal code or anything like that. This is more of a dharma shastra. It lays down the right way of living. Dharma for us these days has become more of a ritual, and we understand rituals by this word. But actually, dharma means the right way of living. And this is what we find in Manusmriti. This dharma is what Manusmriti describes is manav dharma. See, you can understand as people whom I presume are of an educated, maybe scientific background, that any right way of living has to be for all of mankind. It cannot be for certain specific people who live in certain area and who follow a certain religion, quote unquote. So therefore, it has to be something which exists for the whole of mankind. And that is what this Manusmriti Dharma Shastra is. In fact, just as an aside, Hinduism is not a word which exists in our ancient texts. There is no such word as Hindu. And always human beings are addressed. Hindu is actually a corruption of Sindhu, which is what the Middle Easterners used to call the people who live beyond the Indus River. So this dharma, which Manusmriti propagates, is sarvabhaum, sarvakalik, and sarvajanik. Sarvabhaum means that it is valid in all the places on the planet. It is not as if you are in India, then this thing works. If you are in another country, it doesn't work. As I told you, it is for mankind. Therefore, it has to be for mankind which exists on this planet, and maybe even in other places in the universe, because really speaking, man is the epitome of God's creation, and therefore they would be existing in other parts of the universe. And those will also have similar laws. Then sarvakalik, at all times, these laws are valid. It is not as if they are valid when you are praying or when you are sitting in meditation or when you are doing a particular job. They are valid at all times. Then sarvajanik, they are applicable to everybody. It is not for a particular community or for a particular people. So it is sarvabhaum, sarvakalik, and sarvajanik. This law, if we can call it, or dharma, has played a great role in the preparation of the Hindu law of our constitution. In 1794, during the British rule, when something like a constitution was being devised for the populace, then William Jones set out to translate Manusmriti. And that is when the first translation of Manusmriti in modern times has come about. Before that, it possibly lost its importance so much. But yet, William Jones picked it up, because even in that British period, it was still valid and was being followed by Hindus to a large extent. So now that bit of Manusmriti has continued into our constitution as well, and has been the basis on which the Constitution of India has developed. But not only that, we find it to be part of the constitution in countries which are influenced greatly by Indian culture. These are mostly Southeast Asian countries like the Philippines, Vietnam, Thailand, Indonesia. In fact, I understand that in Philippines, in front of the parliament, there is a statue of Manu which is there. I have not been able to corroborate this fact, but this is what I understand. I've heard from a particular source. Here, as we know, we had a great fight because one statue of Manu Smriti was put in front of the Rajasthan Vidhan Sabha, and one case went up to the Supreme Court. Finally, they were allowed to keep it, but there was opposition. So this is the way India is at the moment. Anyhow, so this the how ancient this text is can be gauged from the fact that it is to be found in all our ancient texts. It is completely based on the Vedas. In fact, what it has done is it's kind of taken the Vedic knowledge, which is presented in, you can say, slightly complex manner. And it has taken the parts which are more practical and more important, I can say, in our day-to-day life, and put it in a way which is easily understandable. So it contains both knowledge as well as practices. We will see some of the contents right now. So it is to be found in the Brahmanas, which are the most ancient texts after the Vedas. It is also quoted in the Upanishads. In the Ramayana, it is found at a number of places. In the Mahabharata, it is mentioned many times as the authoritative place to find out what is the right way of living, that is dharma. So we can gauge that this is an extremely ancient text. How ancient it is difficult to say because of its antiquity. You can understand Mahabharata is 5,000 years old and Ramayana is so many years old that I am scared to tell you how old it is. But then how ancient it is, you can gauge. This is the first Smriti text, as it is called, Manu Smriti. So Manu is the one who has given us this Smriti. And these are called Smriti texts, also known as Dharma Shastras. So there are many other Smritis which came after that, like Yajnavalkya Smriti, Parashara Smriti, and so on. They have always referred to Manu Smriti as more authoritative. And in fact, they've taken some verses from Manu Smriti as is into their own Smritis. Even Chanakya has, in his Chanakya Niti, given a lot of things directly from Manu Smriti. So you will find that it follows exactly so. See, the thing is that sometimes we think in our modern times, we feel that things evolve into something which is better. But in our view, in our Indian way of thinking, that is not always so. If I can give you one example, this Sanskrit is a language from which all the regional languages have come out, have evolved, so you can say. And yet all the regional languages are lacking substantially from the perfection that Sanskrit represents. The same thing can be said for Manu Smriti. The perfection of Manu Smriti is not found in other texts. So this is a most important text. Manu has been described as the first king of mankind. What that implies is that before that, there may have been small communities which existed. But Manu is the one who brought them together in the form of a rashtra, a country. And he became the king of that country. Also, he was a sage, rishi. This is the amazing thing about Indian culture, that a person can be a sage as well as a king. He need not necessarily be a bhogi to be a king. By God's grace, we have such a person right now at the helm. However, I shall not comment too much about that. So in Sanskrit terms, it's called Rajarshi. Raja plus Rishi. The text itself starts with a little story which is there, in which other Maharshis, that is great sages, they come to Manu and they say, "O King, you are the knower of the Vedic lore, and you, the way you know it, none of us do, and we would like you to teach us what is written in the Vedas. So then Manu starts his preaching. That preaching has been recorded, legend goes, and it is found in one of the later verses, by his son and student Bhrigu, who has recorded his teachings as is. So you must not think they are Bhrigu's teachings, but they are Manu's teachings only. These teachings relate to all aspects of the human life, for people from all walks of life and communities and nations as a whole. That means you have a personal set of rules, and you have a samajik or community level set of rules, and you have the country level set of rules. In my talk today, I will be discussing more about the personal aspect. Obviously, this is such a large text, I cannot cover too much of it. I hope to be able to give you a little glimpse of the other sections too, or at least just I'll touch upon them. So this being such an ancient text, there are a number of corruptions which are to be found. The text has become huge over so many millennia, which it has been there. And as I was telling you around the turn of the Gregorian calendar, that is around 1 BC, actually around 3rd century BC, when we see Buddhism and Jainism coming into to the fore, that was actually as a rebellion to the bad practices, the malpractices which had entered Hinduism. And these had actually got infiltrated into Manusmriti. Manusmriti being a dharma shastra which tells you how to live your life, how nice it is if you can insert your own views on what should be done into the text. Then everybody starts following that text. And so the scholarship of the Brahmanas was coming down, and now they wanted to put in their own varchasva. They had to maintain their authority. So for that, what they did is they inserted their own verses. So a number of verses are found which are contradictory to other verses which exist. So most of the contradictions are related to the caste system and the position of women and shudras in society. And that is why, you know, you hear of this Manu Adi Takate, which Mayavati talks about, because the shudras feel that they have been shown in a bad light, and have there's some things which are imposed on them which are not correct. Actually, the spread of Manu Smriti to different countries, its existence in India even to date, is proof itself of how fair and just the system is which Manu has proposed. And it cannot, as you will see by a few of the things which I will tell you, it cannot be bettered. So these things are seen as some things which are a corruption. So there are some people who have worked on it, one of them being Dr. Surendra Kumar, who has worked hard on this and compared it with the Vedic philosophy, and found out what is the Vedic philosophy saying and what is the Manu Smriti verse saying. And wherever it was against the Vedic philosophy, he's eliminated that verse and kept the verse which was according to the Vedic philosophy. He has thus whittled away quite a few verses. The text has reduced to, I can say, almost half its size. This he has called Vishuddha Manusmriti. It is available on Amazon. If you like, you could check that out. So Manusmriti consists of 12 chapters, and there are this around 3,000 verses which are there. These relate to creation of the universe, the Varna system, dharma, that is duties and ethics, 16 sanskaras. You would have heard of these Shodasha sanskaras. These are the different phases of our life. We have different rituals which are performed. So you would be familiar with the Vivaha Sanskar, the Antyeshti Sanskar, the Namkaran Sanskar. These are some of the ones which remain in our life. But actually 16 Sanskaras have been ordained. Then there are four ashramas, which are parts of our life, different ways in which life is to be lived. These I will be covering in greater detail. Then the types of marriages. The various ways in marriages can happen, which are the good ways and which are the bad ways. Then Pancha Mahayajnas, which are daily duties, which again I will be covering later on. Diet and hygiene. So what you should eat, what you should not eat, how you should clean yourself, how should you clean your vessels, etc. All that is also given. Qualifications and responsibilities of people in authority, that has been given. The setting up of committees by the king, judicial, administrative, etc. Basically, three committees have been defined by Manu. But he has said that many departments will also exist, and the whole structure has been given by him, which is quite amazing, actually, if you really consider how systems were even in around first century AD in other parts of the world. We see that maybe Greece was the first country where such a system developed, a structure for the country. Even in Egypt, which is so much doubted, there is the king was supreme, and the moment he came onto the throne, he started building tombs for himself, and the whole all the workers, artisans were involved in that. So the population just survived kind of on their own. So in China also we see some development around that time, 2,000, 3,000 years ago. But otherwise, such a very systematic system is hardly found in ancient texts. This Manusmriti being, of course, much older than all these systems. Then settlement of disputes, a whole series of disputes have been mentioned. These are legal disputes, which can happen between the worker and the employer, between the wife and the husband, and so on. All kinds of disputes have been mentioned, and some indication has been given of how the dispute needs to be resolved. What are witnesses? What is the qualification of a witness? Which witness to believe, which not to believe, and so on. And of course, some prescriptions for the judge. Then it talks about atonement or prayaschit. So some papas which you have committed, how to atone for them. That has also been mentioned. Then we have the law of karma. As you know, our Indian system is based on the law of karma and reincarnation. So since you are born again and again, you have to make the what you carry forward with you is your karma. And therefore you must make sure that you perform the right karma. So that has been defined by Manu, and then salvation or moksha. Moksha is again a concept which you will find only in very, very developed cultures. And you will find that all of them link back to India and I would say Vedas and Manusmriti. So salvation is one of those. Okay, so I had told you I will speak to you about ashramas. So the Vedas define that the average human life should be an average, okay, not the maximum human life, should be 100 years. So that was a level of life expectancy in those days. So that human life is divided into four quarters. And these quarters are called ashramas, in which different work is performed. Shrama, as you know, is some perseverance, some activity which you perform. So these define the activities which are performed in different stages of life. And these are beautiful stages, actually. If you see, it makes a lot of sense to us even today. So the first stage, which consists of 25 years, is called Brahmacharya, which is devoted to education. So the higher education is, of course, that of the Vedas, scriptures, and things like mathematics and astronomy and so on. However, there is room also for vocational training in this time. So typically a person would graduate at the end of 25 years, but this is just a directive. You may take more than 25 years or you may finish your studies before 25 years, after which you enter Grihastha Ashram. That is, you start a family. You get married and you start a family. Plus you take up a job. So at this time, you start contributing to society. As part of the family, you raise children who who grow up to form members of the society. So you give them a good training to be good members, citizens of the country. Also, you perform economic activities which lead to the wealth of the nation. So this Grihastha Ashram is actually the main economic wheel of the society, and it provides the basis for all the other three ashramas. All the other three ashramas depend on the Grihastha Ashram. On the other side, Grihastha Ashram is the time when the human being enjoys maximum. They have the family, they have all the comforts of living, they are performing some service to society and enjoying living. That is why most people die as grihasthis, because this is an easy ashrama and we get stuck to it. However, the scriptures provide us a different path. So they say that at around 50, you should leave your home and you should head for the forest. Forest means essentially a secluded place. In those days, you could go and live in the forest because there were ashramas which existed of other vanaprasthis, and you could join them or you could start your own ashrama there. And you could take your spouse along as well, or even other people who were interested in taking vanaprastha. You went over there, and one of the major activities, or rather I should say two of the major activities which you performed, was one was that you had to study the spiritual texts and perform meditation. And the other thing was to perform yajnas. Yajnas are means by which you you remove the toxins from the environment. That is the main reason why yajnas are really important. This underlying message has been lost over the centuries, but that is the reason why you perform yajnas. Yajnas are not any magical thing, but they are things which actually, if done properly, they are very good for the environment. They remove toxins from the air, and which leads to rainwater also being purified, and that makes the ground also pure. So all three parts, the skies and the ground and the water, they are purified by yajnas. So you are supposed to perform yajnas as set out by the Vedas and other dharma shastras and griha sutras, non-griha sutras, dharma shastras and kalpa shastras, very diligently. That is called vanaprastha. Then you take sannyas. At the end of 25 years of vanaprastha, when you would be around 75 years, you are now, you have reached that level of virakti, of renunciation, that now you are close to God, you are close to seeing your soul, and it is time that you gave up everything and started moving around as a sannyasi. A sannyasi is not supposed to stay in a particular place, because even staying in a particular place can lead to an attachment to that place. So it is not seen as a good idea for the sannyasi to stick around somewhere, anywhere for a long time. They move from place to place. They accept bhiksha from the grihasthis wherever they go, and they give upadesh to those grihasthis in return, and also up to the king, they are known to have given upadesh. This life is further supposed to have four goals to it. These are dharma. So this is the first goal of life, that what is the right way of living? What is paropkar? What should I do for others? What should I do for myself? What is the right way of conduct? All that is called dharma. I will be telling you a little more about dharma in greater detail towards the end. The next goal of life is artha. Using dharma, you earn money to fulfill your desires, which are called kama. So all your comforts, your family, etc., those are your kamnai, those are your desires. So you obtain money in order to fulfill your desires. Subsequently, you gun for moksha. Moksha means search for oneself, one's own soul. You have till now been feeding your body. Now you have to move on to looking for yourself, the soul which is hidden inside this body, and for looking for God. So those are the things which you see in moksha. So now here you can see these also link up with the ashramas which we did in the last slide. Dharma is what you learn in brahmacharya. So brahmacharya, you are devoid of responsibilities. You just learn what is the right way of living, what is dharma. Then in grihastha ashram, you focus on artha and kama. So both go hand in hand, and you are performing your duties to the society. At the same time, you are enjoying life. Then you give up everything and take up vanaprastha and sannyas in the search for moksha. So your lakshya moves from dharma, artha and kama towards moksha. Now I'll tell you about the pancha mahayajnas for the grihasthi. These pancha mahayajnas are also called mahavratas and are to be performed by the grihasthi every day. They are called mahavratas because they are difficult to perform. Yajna is also an activity which is not something which you would do in a normal course of life. That is why they have been ordained that you should do it. So the first Mahayajna is Brahma Yajna. So you would think it is all about sitting in meditation and all, but that is not it. So much as of studying texts that are related to dharma, spirituality. So this, and also other forms of study, but Brahma Yajna is more focused on spirituality. So the grihasthi should take out some time during the course of the day, not perform only worldly duties all the time, but should spend some time every day to study these spiritual texts and maintain that link with God. Most essential. Then the next one is Deva Yajna, which is the performance of Agnihotra, all the havans and the homas which are to be performed. There are there's a small version of havan which is performed daily in the morning and in the evening at dawn and at dusk, the Sandhi Kala is called. None of us perform those yajnas that day these days, but this was meant to be performed twice a day. As I told you, this is most important for removing the pollution, particularly that which you are generating every day. The environment should be cleansed of it every day. Then Pitra Yajna. This again, you may connect with Shraddha for dead ancestors, but actually Pitra Yajna is taking care of your living elderly persons, senior citizens, and making them happy, keeping them happy. So service to the elderly is Pitra Yajna, the living ancestors. Then Bali Vaishvadeva Yajna, this refers to giving particularly food to other Kshudra Jantus, lesser forms of life. For example, here you see a man feeding the birds. So similarly, you can even leave for cockroaches, ants, and so on, some food, or give food to stray dogs, or even to leprosy patients and stuff like that. People who are not able to earn themselves and who are in need. That also comes under Bali Vaishvadeva Yajna. Then we have Atithi Yajna. Atithi Yajna, we understand as that for guests who come to our place, we should take care of them and give them good food and give them a comfortable place to stay and take care of them and make them happy. But actually this Atithi refers to somebody who, when he is coming, the day on which he is going to come is not defined, is Atithi. And it basically refers to the sannyasi who comes at your door for bhiksha. So the sannyasi may also stay with you, though it has been said that the sannyasi should stay elsewhere, away from grihasthis. So taking care of the sannyasi and the sannyasi's needs is the main part of Atithi Yajna, actually. Now the Varna system. Varna system is a Varna word, originates from Varan Karna, or Vara, as you know, Vara, Vadu. So Vara refers to choosing something, selecting something. This is in contrast to the Jati, which we talk about today. So in the ancient texts, Jati refers to something by birth, and it refers to the species. So Manushya Jati is a correct usage, but Brahman Jati is actually not correct. It is Brahman Varn, which is the correct word. So it is something which is chosen. So now this corruption which has come, supposedly due to Manusmriti, which I will show you how it is not in the next slide, is actually by selection of a profession. So now let us look at the four jatis that we are aware of, the four varnas actually, and what are what do they actually refer to. So the first one is Brahman. So Brahman is anybody who is involved in either educating himself or others. So it is most important, this is, you know, knowledge is given a lot of importance in the Indian tradition, and therefore the Brahman is supposed to be at the peak of this hierarchy. He is supposed to know what is dharma. That learning of dharma is the main idea of a Brahman. The word brahmacharya itself shows you how Brahma or God is of supreme importance, and Brahman is also derived from that. He is supposed to be close to Brahman. And knowledge in our system is not restricted to just spiritual knowledge. As you see, saw in the previous slide, Manu himself has given creation of the universe and creation of all the things that we see around us. So all knowledge, all facts, all science, all biology, everything is considered as something which leads us towards moksha. Understanding the universe is of prime importance. And number of you in our modern times, we do have a scientific grounding, and we reject superstitions. Yet we fall into superstitions very often because we don't have this grounding that what is fact and what is fiction, how to distinguish between something which is a superstition. The next is Vaishya. So Vaishya is the economic engine of society. He is the person or she is the person who is involved in earning money, in moving things in the nation. So any, like you are seeing a farmer here, farmers are Vaishyas, all artisans and all businessmen, all of these people are Vaishyas. Anybody who is producing goods, earning wealth for the nation is a Vaishya. Then Kshatriya. Kshatriya you may know as just a king, but anybody who is in the armed forces, who is involved in the defense of the nation and the administration of the nation is called a Kshatriya. So even an, a soldier is a Kshatriya, and an IAS officer is a Kshatriya. When you look at Shudras, Shudras are people who are those who are involved in the service industry, as we could say. So drivers, cooks, anybody in that kind of service. is called a Shudra. So as you can see, Shudra is not something which is demeaning, which is an untouchable or somebody to be looked down upon. In fact, sociologists have found that the Indian social structure, that is this Varna system, it survived for millennia, thousands of years, because it provided room for people who could not complete education. See, one should accept as a fact of life that there are people who are very intelligent and the people who have difficulty in studies. So if society does not give them a room, a respectable place, a respectable job by which they can earn their living without having necessarily a BA degree or an MSc degree, there should be jobs which are available to people in the service industry. And because this place was defined in our texts from the Vedas themselves of a Shudra, it was just a position in society for people who were less educated. So these Shudras, because of this structure, our society has survived for a very long time. It is a very fair structure and which is dependent on the profession which we accept. So as proof of the fact that Manu did not say that this one was imposed on you by birth, I am giving you this verse. But before that, I would also like to tell you that actually Manu has said in another verse in a short way that all of us are born as Shudras. Why Shudras? Because they know less. So they are ill-educated. So we come with no knowledge. And therefore, we are born as Shudras. And then as we proceed in life and then we accept some profession, that is when we become something else. So in this verse, Manu says that Shudra Brahmanatam Eti, that Shudra can become a Brahman, and a Brahmanascha Chati Shudratam, Brahman can become a Shudra, and similarly Vaishya and Kshatriya, based on their knowledge, behavior, and profession. So if you lose your knowledge, then you go down, and you could, a Brahman could become a Shudra. So this you can see why the Brahmanas of you know 1 AD or something like that during the Buddhism and Jainism period, they were becoming very jittery because they had stopped studying the texts and their knowledge was diminishing. They were becoming Shudras. So they had to put in verses which said that the Shudra should not be taught the Vedas, women should not be taught the Vedas. All that they had to put in, and plus they put in that it is by birth, nobody can be, nobody who is born a Brahman can become less than a Brahman. But Manu has stated very clearly, even when you see the duties of the Brahman, Kshatriya, Vaishya, and Shudra, you will find that he has defined the duties as I have told you very clearly. And if you fall from those duties, you stop performing those duties, then you are no longer that one. Another area where Manu Smriti is maligned is the role of women, because there's supposed to be a verse in Manu Smriti which says that women, dogs, and drums should be beaten. On the other hand, I will show you this verse which says, Arthasya Sangrahe Chainam Vyaye Chaiva Niyojaye. That is, the wife should be in charge of the family, family's wealth and its expenditure. So the money is to be handed over to the woman. She is in charge of the running of the house. So while the man is principally in charge of the profession which he takes up outside, though the woman could also work, this is not to negate the fact that the woman is not to work, but the principal duty of the woman is the home. So she also has to maintain hygiene in the house and of the family. In dharma, all the Vedic rituals which were to be performed, the woman is actually the one who is responsible. And if you think about it, even today, it is women who will say, let us perform a Grah Pravesh, let us perform this ritual. This is a tradition which is continuing in our society. For the family, the woman is responsible for the dharma. And the corollary too of this is that how can the woman know dharma if she's not educated? So to say that Manusmriti says that women should not be educated, they should not study Vedas, etc., is really, really against the principles of Manu. And so she should also be involved in cooking and in looking after everything in general of the house. As I told you, she is the queen of the house and everybody has to obey her wishes. It has been said that, again, in one of the verses, that the men in the family should keep the women folk in the family happy. That is when the family as a whole is happy. If women are not happy in the family, then it is not possible for others to be happy. Also, I want to show you this verse, which says that the king should determine the status and the salaries of the people involved in the duties towards a nation, including women, striyam, as you can see, which are based on the nature of work. So this very clearly implies that women were involved in working. At no point should it be said that Manu has said that women should not be educated, should not work outside the house, etc., etc. That is not correct. See, even in today, when you are writing a text, as a short form, you use a pronoun he, okay? But that does not mean it eliminates she. He includes she. So when you are saying that when he sits in the car, he should start the ignition, that does not mean when she sits in the car, she should not start the ignition. So we often use he as a short form of she. And this is a tradition which is coming right from Vedic times. Many times it is very clearly stated that he includes she. But sometimes it is not. It is to be understood. For example, here it is very clear that women also should work. Now I want to show you a very unique aspect of Manusmriti. I hope I have covered the two main objections against Manusmriti and you have got an idea why it is incorrect. Now I want to give you another view of Manusmriti. This is a slightly scientific view. This is the classification of beings. You would not think this is a subject which is covered in Manusmriti, but it is. A lot of science is there in Manusmriti. So Manu has classified beings in the following order. So there are these that are born alive from a womb. Today we call them viviparous, viviparous animals. And a large chunk of viviparous, in fact, as far as I know, all viviparous animals are mammals. So that is what Manu has also said. Pashava, that is the animals, the mammals which are found in villages, towns, like cows, sheep, etc. And Mriga, that is wild animals. Vyala, which is like tigers and leopards and so on, which are Hinsra. Mriga is non-violent animals like deer, etc. And Vyala is violent animals like lion and so on. And I want to draw your attention to the next word, which is Ubhaya to dataha. Ubhaya to dataha means they have teeth on both sides of the jaw. Now, you can say that even sharks have on both sides of the jaw, but and all fishes kind of have, a lot of animals have teeth, which exist on two sides. But if you think about it, those teeth are not, they interlock. They're not used for chewing, like in the case of mammals. Those, the mammalian teeth are meant for mastication. They grind the food into smaller particles and their digestive system is more sophisticated because of that reason, that you are digesting it and you can use greater parts of the food which you eat instead of just swallowing and then throwing it out. Mostly it goes out undigested. This has been recognized scientifically only of late, that development of masticatory teeth is a huge step in evolution. And here you find it in Manusmriti, such an ancient text. It is so unbelievable. Okay, then also he says Rakshansi Pishashascha Manushayascha. So this Rakshansi are, that is Rakshasas, are not people with, you know, vampire teeth, but they are actually people who do not follow Vedic Dharma, but otherwise okay, reasonable people. Then you have Pishachas, who are not only do they not follow Vedic Dharma, but they are actually cannibals and eat humans themselves. Then you have Manushyas, which are Manudhati, Manujati, who think, that is, they think about their duties and follow the Vedas and perform, follow the Vedic tradition. They are called Manushyas or Aryas, as we know. So those are Jarayujas, that is viviparous animals born out of Jara, that is a womb. And then you have as a opposed to that Andajas, which today is also defined as oviparous. So oviparous are all the birds and snakes and crocodiles and fishes and tortoises and so on. So all these are placed as oviparous animals. Next is a most interesting category called Swedajam. Sweda, sweat directly comes from Sweda. Sweda means, one of the meanings is sweat, but the implication is here of an environment which is humid and warm, damp and warm environment, which, as you know, leads to a lot of mosquitoes and bed bugs, flies, and not only that, all bacteria, viruses, fungi, all those unicellular creatures also come under Swedajam. The next is the plant kingdom, that is Udbhijas, they are called. So Udbhid, that means they arise on breaking the soil. So they arise out of seed, bij, kand, prarohana, that are born out of either seeds or kand, that is vegetative reproduction. Today also we classify the reproduction mechanism of plants into two. One is through seeds, which is called sexual reproduction, and through vegetative reproduction, which is done through cuttings, etc., or through the root, the next plant grows. So this is so amazing that this classification, which has come into Western science only of the from the last 300 years or so, exists in such an ancient text, and it is relevant even today. By this very indication, you should also understand how all the other parts of Manusmriti are relevant today. There is no knowledge which ever becomes irrelevant. And so all great knowledge remains relevant at all times. That is what Manusmriti is. The other thing I wanted to show you here, that the fact that plants are living beings has come into our consciousness. While Indians have always known that plants are living, but in the Western consciousness, this fact has come only again very recently. In Manusmriti, he says, antah sanna bhavanti ete sukh dukh samanvita, that these plants are internal. Their emotions are bent internally. So they don't reflect it outside like other animals, but they sukh dukh, they do feel happiness and sorrow. It is not as if they are devoid of all sensation. They do feel them, but it is all felt inside. It is not shown outside. That means they are living things. This is another fantastic part, which you would not expect some very tribal civilization to come out with. Okay, now let us look at dharma. Today we understand dharma as religion, constituting of so many rituals which you have to perform. Once you have done your ritual, you are done. And if you by chance perform some papas, you go to Ganga and get rid of it. But in our ancient texts, dharma, as I have been repeatedly telling you, is the right way of living life. So let us look at what Manu says about what is dharma. So he has given us one set of ways in which to identify dharma, the right way to proceed in life. So he said the topmost authority, which tells us what to do and what not to do, are the Vedas. Next are the dharma shastras or smritis, where the maharshis have sat down and extracted the things which are relevant for us and put it down in words which are easy for us to comprehend. Then sadachara, when we are not conversant with the Vedas or even the smriti texts, we should look at how good people go about in life, and we should try and emulate them. That is sat achar, sat janah ye santi tesham acharaham. So we should copy their achar, the way they behave. Then swasya cha priyam atmanah, God has put inside us one still small voice, as it is called, which our conscience, which tells us that this is right, this is wrong. When we are doing something wrong, we have fear, we feel shy, we look around, is somebody looking at us when we are going to do that thing? So this God has put in this bit of dharma inside us directly, and we should listen to that voice and not do things which make us feel that no, this is not the right thing. We should be always comfortable with what is available. So this he has called Sakshat Dharmasya Lakshanam. These are things which are available to us directly. Then he has given further a breakup of what dharma consists of. This is again a very extraordinary classification. So he says dhriti, which means patience. So patience he has put in first, that the first thing you need to be a dharmic person is patience. Because very often life throws at us things which make us very agitated. And because of that, we land up doing things which are not good. Also, you know, bad things are easier to do because they are more comfortable for us to do. But continuing on the straight and narrow path, as it is called, is that much more difficult. So you have to inculcate patience inside you to continue on the dharmic path. So patience is the first virtue. Then kshama. Kshama, mercy is one angle of kshama, but again, forbearance. That is when people throw bricks and bats at you, you do not lose your own spiritual compass, your ethical compass. That is what is meant by kshama, that accept the good and bad in life. Then dhammaha. Dhamma is control of the mind. So, you know, our mind tends to drive us in certain directions, and we have desires towards certain things and we hate certain things. So rag and dvesh is there inside us. That we should not follow that. Whatever dharma we have learned from Veda, Smriti, Sadachara and Swasya cha priyam atmana, that is where what should drive our behavior and not where our body is pushing us. Then asteyam. Asteyam is non-covetousness. We should not want to steal things from other people. We should not have irsya towards, if somebody has something more than us, we should not envy that person. Even envy in thought is like stealing. So you should not envy anybody, and you should not definitely steal. Then shaucham. Shaucham is mental and physical hygiene. So our minds also, we should keep free of bad thoughts and not gossip, etc. and so on. And also physically, our bodies should, we should maintain cleanliness. Indriya nigraha, our senses, we should control. We should be controlling them. The senses should not be controlling us. Dhi. Dhi means buddhi. So a great importance is put on developing the intellect, and in all activities which develop your intellect, and to stay away from activities which reduce your intellect. For example, I can give you one, if one takes drugs or alcohol, that brings down your awareness, your comprehension of things. So one should stay away from Madeira, etc. And you should, on the other hand, eat things which improve your mental capacity. Vidya. Vidya is directly knowledge. So the acquisition of knowledge is also of great importance. As we are seeing all these things, Veda, Smriti, if you have not read Veda, if you have not read Smriti, then you don't know what is the right thing to do. So Vidya is also of great importance. But again, let me emphasize, it is not only spiritual knowledge, but all kinds of knowledge of this universe is Vidya. Actually, you will see that people like Einstein were also extremely spiritual. You automatically become spiritual if you are involved in some area of study. So if any of you, if you are involved in some area of study, you will see that your focus towards bad things of life has reduced, and you are becoming more focused in your views, in good thoughts. Satyam. Satya is of primary importance. I would say anybody who wants to step out on a spiritual quest has to first learn to be honest. If you do not think and say and do the same thing, if there is a difference in your speech and what you think and between your action and your words, then you are not following Satya. And that immediately eliminates you actually from the spiritual path. Then akrodha. Akrodha is not becoming angry. This is the other side of dhriti. So you should try and control your anger. All of us become angry at some time because of our own personal desires. So we should learn to control our anger. So these are the 10 things which make up dharma. I hope this changes your overall view of what is meant by dharma in our ancient texts. Further, he tells us that how dharma proceeds, how we proceed on the path of dharma. So he says that if you follow adharma, then you will find that you will move up very fast in life, and you will get all the comforts of life, all riches will come to you, and power will come to you. People will come to you with bowed heads, and then they will come. You will even conquer your enemies, and then you will be destroyed in a moment from your very base. Your whole from the root, you will be destroyed. There are many such examples of this in history. If you go back and look at it. If I may give two small ones, you can think of Ziaul-Haq and Idi Amin, Ziaul-Haq of Pakistan and Idi Amin of this thing. But in recent times also, of late, we are seeing one person being destroyed who was following a path of dharma. I leave it to you to guess. Then, on the other hand, people who are following the path of dharma, they will invariably have a difficult time. The people who are following adharma normally have a very cool, relaxed time, and their path seems to be, paved with flowers and with gold. But for the dharmic person, he has to collect punya, just like a termite makes a house. That is what sanchinuyad valmikam eva puttika. Puttika is termite, and valmika is the anthill, the termite hill which is created. So like a termite, he has to come and put bits of wet mud on it and so build up the termite hill. That is how it is with dharma. Paraloka sahayartham. You should help other people, and sarva bhutani apidayan, and make sure that you don't hurt other beings. Bhutani beings, sarva bhutani, all beings. So not only human beings, but also other living creatures. Because this helps you in your afterlife. Paralok sahayartham meant for benefiting you in your next life, paralok. Another aspect of dharma which Manu has given is Satya. So I just wanted to tell you more about Satya, because we have kind of forgotten about this today. And I think I'm exceeding my time a little bit, so I will just quickly wrap this up. So he says that speak the truth, speak what is pleasant. Don't speak the truth which is unpleasant. But also don't speak something which is pleasant but not true. And this is the Sanatan Dharma. So, you know, we have many definitions of Sanatan Dharma today, but this is the definition which Manu has given. He says, Bhadram Bhadram Iti Bruyat, Bhadram Iti Eva Bhavidet. He says that basically whatever you say, the speaker should be clear that it is good for the listener. That should be your criteria. Finally, he says that Eka Eva Suhir Dharma, your only one friend is Dharma, the pap and punya which you have earned. Nidhane Api Anuyatya, which even after you die, it follows you. Everything else dies along with your body. It is only Dharma which you have performed during your life which goes with you. With that, I would like to end. Thank you very much. Namaste. Om Shanti.
Thank you, Uttaraji. It was an excellent talk on Manusmriti. And like you have covered all the misconceptions about this topic. We have enjoyed your lecture today. And I'm pretty sure everybody on the Rishi Vatika channel has enjoyed this, and they have expressed their gratitude and appreciation. So I want to go over a few of the comments that I see. Dr. Guru Prasad Kuppa Garu, all law schools should teach this Indian ancient laws. And Neeraj Sekonji says, beautiful analysis on Tuthi. Devi Prasad Vojjala Garu says, as there are many misconceptions, this knowledge must be part of school's school level curriculum. And you have brought out many beautiful things in easily understanding manners. So a lot of appreciations to her, to you.
Thank you.
I personally learned a lot of things today. As you have mentioned, like it's very interestingly understanding about Manusmriti, very well explained about like ashramas of individuals, Varna as per proficiency or and profession, not by birth. So that was like very well explained. Like you are not born as Brahmin or like Vaishya, then like by profession. So it's very well explained. And then role of a woman, my favorite one. So you have mentioned about yagnas, right? So is yagna and homam same thing?
Yes. In the text, they do have a distinction because many kinds of yajnas are defined. But overall, in common terms, they are the same. Yajna, hom, havan, agnihotra, they all refer to the same thing. But otherwise, you have very specific yajnas which are performed like dash, pornamas, and so on, which are given in our Kalpa Shastras. But overall, yajna and home is the same.
So you have mentioned about like some Brahma yajna and other yajnas. So when we do a Gruha Pravesham, we do Vastu Homam. When somebody is like birthdays, we do Ayush Homam. So those homams, are they considered as Brahma yajnams or like whatever you mentioned?
Firstly, this Agnihotra is Deva yajna. So then these homams which you perform for Gruha Pravesh and so on are actually part of the Shodasha Sanskaras. So the 16 Sanskaras which are there, we are performing just a very small subset of them. All of them involve that Deva Yajna, that is Homa. So that is why we always perform a Homa in the wedding, in the Namkaran, in the Gruha Pravesh. All are, whatever sanskaras which we do in life, the main thing will become the center point is the home. Oh. It's actually the sanskara. Nice. But there are other sanskaras which actually do not have a home too. For example, what we call baby shower for women, for pregnant women, that is also mentioned. It is one of the sanskaras which is called Simanto Nayan, which is to make the pregnant woman happy at that very critical third to sixth month period, when the woman starts feeling a little bit depressed. So there are all these 16 sanskaras, also a very beautiful thing, which actually is worth a study in itself. It should be looked at.
Thank you so much for explaining me. So there are a few questions, I think. Devi Prashad Vajjala Garu, we request madam to share the PDF version or link of the source of this Manusmriti. These are needed to be remembered, like Gita Shlokas. If she share it with us, can you please share?
I would be most happy to. Where should I share it with you?
So please send it to Gadadharji, and then he can post it, upload, and then post a link in the same place. And Pradeep Chandagaru asked the question, what has angered Dr. Ambedkarji to burn the book Manusmriti?
Actually, I don't know too much about Ambedkarji, but the little that I know, he was not out and out against Manusmriti. This anger against Manusmriti is, of course, originating out of ignorance, which has come down over the period of time. You know, we sometimes think that Ambedkar was against Indian culture as a whole, and yet we know he was the first person to speak Sanskrit in the parliament, and he said that Sanskrit is the greatest language in the world. He studied Indian law, that means Manusmriti also, while making the constitution of the country. So I'm not very sure. I cannot say authoritatively anything about this, but there are these conflicting pieces of information. Sometimes some things we don't give too much credence to, and so we forget about it and just focus on this very negative part.
Nice. I know. There are a few more comments I want to go over. Thanks for such a nice lecture on Manusmriti. Hari Bhatt Garu says, thank you very much for your excellent and important presentation. There's one more from Guru Prasad Kupparao. We should promote this ancient concept to all. Wonderful to know such great thoughts were existing since 5,000 years and more, maybe 14,000 years, as O says about Ramayana in time. So it's all the comments I'm just reading. There are no questions. So thank you so much. We have enjoyed the lecture, and I hope you had a lot of topics to be covered, and I'm pretty sure this is not giving enough time to cover all of them. Hope like we can catch up on all of those.
Yeah, I do hope that this is only a curtain raiser for everybody, and at least some people in the audience go further and study Manusmriti. As I told you, this one Manusmriti, which is only in Hindi as far as I know, is available on Amazon. Other Manusmritis, you have to read with great care. As I explained, there's a lot of corruption in Manusmriti, so you have to go very carefully in it to get an authentic version. But thank you very much to IIVS for giving me this opportunity. I'm really honored, and I'm happy that I could share my views with such a large audience. Thank you very much.
Oh, very happy to have you on IIVS lecture series, Raji. Thank you all. I'm pretty sure everybody brings up this topic and then reads more carefully about it.
Yeah, that would be wonderful.
So that's all for today. Thank you for you, Uttaraji. And thank you all for tuning in on Rishi Vatika YouTube channel today. Namaste and have a pleasant day.
Namaste.